I'm very glad to join you here today. The Lusk Tidy Towns and the effort they have made now to erect the stone at the entrance of the village. I just am bowled over year in and year out that the Tidy Towns and the people working here in Heritage in Lusk managed to find a project each year to remind us of the history of this locality, and they never seem to fail to find something interesting and new to mark the history attached to the area of Lusk. And we all want to know about it, but what's more important, the new young generation that are moving into Lusk, people who perhaps have no contact or connection with Lusk ever before in their lives and are making their lives here in the new houses. Those who were at school here 1500 years ago, you're very welcome here today. You're looking well, I have to say, those of you who started school in the 1500 years ago. I hope you've had a good education. And I'm saying that, and you think that's a joke, but I'm quite sure the people who started their education here 1500 years ago are somewhere up there above us, and they're looking down and saying, little did we know that 1500 years on somebody would be remembering our first faltering steps at education. So to those who are listening and watching and watching over us today, I say thank you for allowing us to remember you here today. Thank you very much.
The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth.
Don't we appear to have a fixation with anniversaries? We celebrate them almost every day. The 1st, the 25th, the 100th, the 1000th, and in this case, 1500 years since Magellan, the Celtic monk, closed his eyes, having served his God and his flock. Today's celebrations could never have been possible without the chain of events spreading over the intervening 1500 years, and I suppose years before Magellan came on the scene either. Now it's very hard to trace back to such a long time ago. 1500 years in human terms is an awful long time, it's 50 generations. So we find it very hard to visualise what things were like then. But if you listen to me now, I'll tell you. Apart from the obvious differences, it was much the same. But there were people, and people, particularly Irish people, remain much the same. They're born, they live, eat, sleep, worry, work, fall in love, hate each other, get sick and die. One generation after another, they keep doing it. And any day, whether it's June 1996 or December 452 or April 2099, first and foremost, today. Yesterday's gone. And tomorrow is not a problem. So what am I getting at? This. People are always people, and change takes a very long time. Did St. Patrick not come to Ireland and convert all the people in no time at all? Not to mention banish the snakes and invent the shamrock? Sorry, but the answer is more complex than that. There weren't any snakes anyway. There were some Christians here before St. Patrick ever landed. He just speeded up the process of converting the people, and he started around these parts. If you want to know why, hang on, we'll go back a few hundred years more and talk religion. Now, just because the Irish were not Christian in the past doesn't mean that they had no religion at all. Not a bit of it. The first thing a person wants when they start to mature is to live forever. So, an afterlife is required. Of course, before that you need a crop every year, your cattle to thrive. You do not need storms, floods, disasters of any description. No. Look around you. You're an Irish person several thousand years ago. What keeps you alive? The sun. Therefore, the sun is what you worship. And for good luck, throw in the moon, the wind, the sea, the earth itself, anything you don't fully understand that seems powerful and useful. Then take anything that lives a long, long time. White thorns, oak trees. Use them to commune with nature and the earth. This is a short way to give an idea of the religious beliefs of our very distant ancestors. But they had a long established religion and relationship with the earth and the planets. They believed that their ancestors lived on in the spirit world, and their priests looked after them in much the same way as our Christian priests minister to us today.
There was a time in Ireland before the cross was raised, when the mountains all were forested and wild deer grazed. A boy was taken captive from his Roman home in Wales to herd sheep upon a mountain in frost and wind and hail. Oh, Patrick, in your vision you were called on to be brave and go back among the people who had used you as a slave.
Early in the 5th century, the Pope was a gentleman by the name of Celestine, who was concerned with spreading Christianity and with serving Christians everywhere. Even as early as the year 400 AD, there were some Christians in Ireland. The Pope felt that they should be ministered to, and so he sent a bishop called Germanus to Britain. He in turn sent a monk, Palladius, to Ireland, but he met with a very poor welcome. Then, around 432, Patrick arrived in Ireland, into Strangford Loch, and started his mission. His method was to first baptize the ruler of an area, then his people would quickly follow. We believe that he landed again near Malahide and slowly followed the coastline to where Skerries is today. He had problems with the ruling families and the local druids, so the legend has it he put to sea and landed on the island which now bears his name. St. Patrick's Island, Holy Island, Church Island, call it what you like, but it's rumoured that the saint, for his own safety and that of his followers, set up a temporary headquarters here and raised a chapel. This simple chapel lived on in many shapes for hundreds of years. A monastery grew on this tranquil island, and from here the rest of the local area was converted. Of course, Patrick moved rapidly away from here. He moved inland and northwards, where he set up his ruling church in Armagh. In a direct line from St. Patrick, Armagh is still the ruling church on the island of Ireland. St. Patrick's Island became a very important part of Christianity in the area. There was a synod of the church held here in an attempt to bring the Irish church into line with Rome. The Norsemen raided the island heavily in the 9th century, but the clergy held on until 1270 or thereabouts, when most of the human population left for the safety of the mainland. Today, all we'll find on the island is the wind, the sea, the seals and the birds, and a few stones to mark 700 years of worship.
Thank you.
The young flame of Christianity was nurtured by St. Macalen at Lusk for quite a few years at the end of the 5th century. And then shortly afterwards, it moved here to the quiet peace of St. Patrick's Island off Skerries. Today, a sleepy, deserted spot. But down the centuries, for maybe 1,200 years, it was a centre of Christianity in this area. What's left here at the moment is this stone building, these couple of arches, the remnants of the last church which was built on this site. And the only little clue we have is a remembrance of St. Patrick here in the window. Surely you can see the silhouette of the saint framed in stone.
There was a time in Ireland before the cross was raised, when the High King ruled a Tara and pagan fires blazed. Patrick preached before him, though the Druids did not agree, and he used the three-leaf shamrock to explain the Trinity. Oh, Patrick, they were routed, just as smoke dispersed by wind, and the word of God in Ireland to this day never dimmed.
St. Macalen certainly learned and developed his faith on the island, and from here he returned to the mainland to bring the message to his people. Macalen was a well-respected man in his community, what we'd call a decent man. He was a member of the ruling clan, the Cianacht. He was a kinsman of the local king. Ireland was full of kings at that time. Now we come back to Lusk. Lusk, for thousands of years, had been a famous shrine to the god of the sun, a fellow called Lu MacDaida, who was also the god of genius, of art and skills, and he was well worth his worship. Macalen directed the religion of the people gradually from pagan belief to Christian faith and belief in the Blessed Trinity. Nobody can be exactly sure where he sited his first chapel, but it was on or very near the original place of pagan worship. Macalen lived to see the beginning of the monastery which grew around it, and we believe that when he finally closed his eyes, he was interred in a cave or lusca, which gives the place its name. Over the years, Lusk and Ireland became more Christian. Not that this made them any more religious. Lusk Church itself changed with the times, both in structure and in label, moving from pagan to Christian, to Roman Catholic, Church of Ireland. Now, it's a museum. While the building is now a museum, it is still the Church of St. Macalen. He's remembered in stained glass as a St. Patrick himself. Other happenings, wild and tame, are noted throughout the building. Famous people are recorded in stone. Spare a thought for the generations of Lusk people not recorded anywhere who have passed on, at home and abroad, pagan and Christian, or call them what you like, but still Lusk people.
Patrick, now a grey old man, was carried to his grave. Four wild oxen wandered until they halted on the soil of the place that became Down Patrick by the banks of the River Quay. Oh, Patrick, in the chapels all the people sing your prayer and commemorate the stranger by whom the cross was raised. We commemorate the stranger by whom the cross was raised.
The Christian church grew in Ireland, a Celtic church, from the early conversions under Patrick and Bridget and our own Macallan. Christianity gradually became one of the greatest forces in the country. It was an Irish church, functioning in its own unique way, and I'm sure Rome and the Pope seemed very far away. The monasteries became cities devoted to learning, universities of belief, dedicating Irish skills in translation, ornamentation, God and the saints, Ireland's golden age. For centuries there were brushes with unruly neighbours. It happened all over the country, but in Lusk armies came from Meath, Ulster and Munster, burning and plundering, but the church survived. Then came a brush with the Vikings, the most dominant race of people ever to stand on earth. I mean, they didn't just go away forever in 1014 after the Battle of Clontarf. No, Dublin was a Danish city and remained so. So did Waterford, Wexford, Carlingford. Don't forget either that Danes fought on both sides in that famous battle. It's a pity, but history is hardly ever as simple as it seems. Yes, these Vikings went on to dominate Europe and ultimately the world. The Norsemen settled in France, Normandy. They became the Normans, dominating France, the Low Countries, Britain, and again poor old Ireland. The Vikings who followed the rivers of Europe settled, founded cities, and flowed out of them. They became the Prussians. The city of Moscow was one of theirs as well. Oh no, the Vikings never went away. Every now and then, we hear people wish to return to the Celtic Church, to a more basic form of faith. I think what they yearn for is innocence, simplicity if you like, a getting away from present-day complications and material values and concerns. It isn't very likely to happen though. Clocks don't work well in reverse. Everything changes as it ages, and so it was with religion. Christianity grew out of Judaism, and it was fresh and new, and it matured and became strong. Of course, Ireland was isolated, but in Europe, the church came to power in political as well as clerical life. The Bishop of Rome was the most powerful man in Europe in the early Middle Ages. The Holy Roman Emperor was his appointee. The Pope commanded armies to do his bidding. In the Crusades, for instance, the idea being to free the holy city of Jerusalem from the grasp of the Islamic Arabs of the region. Perhaps crusaders forgot that Jerusalem and the Holy Land were very important to the Islamic faith as well. It's a strong point of all religions to know beyond doubt that you are right, and your faith is the one true faith, and that every other religion is doomed and damned. The kings of Europe during the early Middle Ages took their turns in Palestine, with their followers, knights, barons, obeying their religion, their pope, and keeping their eyes to the power business. So here we are in the 11th and 12th centuries. Everything in Western Europe is uneasy politically. The pope controls vast income, vast armies, and his allies had to be properly treated. Here we have this misty island in the west, rich monasteries, local leaders quarrelling with one another. An ideal situation for a powerful adventurer to take advantage of. Better still, the Irish church is out of step with the Church of Rome and needs to be regularised. Enter the Normans. Henry II of Normandy and England had plenty of unruly barons in his entourage. Richard de Clare, or Strongbow, was a strong, potentially dangerous rival. Now, with the blessing of Pope Alexander, who did not need anyone out of step with his form of religion, Ireland was formally wrapped up and given to the Norman ruling class. Dermot McMurrough was used as an excuse, one more reason to invade and subdue the country, but the real reason lay firmly in power, religious and political. Before the 12th century ended, Ireland had entered the tortured 800 years of running battle with their nearest neighbours. Even then, things were not so bad, because one Christian religion covered most of Western Europe. But move on a few more years and we find it turning around. The Holy Office was set up by Pope Innocent IV in 1248. It was the tribunal for the suppression of heresy. We know it as the Inquisition. Heresy seemed to cover practically every word, action, or intention not in agreement with the established belief. Education for the common person was frowned upon. Science was seriously restricted. Heresy indeed. Even when Christopher Columbus sailed for America in 1492, his sailors were only waiting to fall over the edge of the earth, which, according to the teaching of the church, was a flat surface around which the sun rotated. Only the other day, the church removed the order of excommunication on Galileo, who was born on February the 15th, 1564, for daring to say that the earth was a round ball which orbited the sun with the other planets in our solar system. And why, you may ask? The answer? Power. The power of church, of state, and the fear of losing it. The Inquisition ran a reign of terror through Italy, Spain, Portugal, Holland, for hundreds of years. People lived in fear and ignorance. The time was right for change, and the change was Reformation. Everyone is familiar with the Reformation. Now, we had several Christian churches, each convinced that theirs was the one and only Church of God, and they were prepared to prove that with fire and steel, torture and execution. What relationship did we have now between organized religion and the fundamental beliefs of faith, love, compassion, poverty, simplicity? It's very hard to see, isn't it? Religion, like nationalism, divided countries, kept people apart. Catholic districts would cheerfully slaughter their Protestant neighbors. Protestants would drive out Catholics from different areas. It happened 500 years ago. It's happening still. Today, in our own super-civilized 20th century, ethnic cleansing in Yugoslavia, dying in Belfast because of the building you worship in. It's very much alive. Religious persecution sent people fleeing to foreign parts. It sent French Huguenots to Dublin. It sent the English Pilgrim Fathers to America with the Russians, the Germans and Greeks. Out of fear came prosperity and safety for the ones who got away. It's so sad to watch what otherwise good and kind people will do to each other in the name of their respective labels. Every political or religious upheaval in Europe could be followed in Ireland through the centuries, and history changed to suit occasions. For instance, the Battle of the Boyne, dearly beloved of Ulster people, was fought not on the 12th, but on the 1st of July, 1690, between a mainly French army led by King James and a mainly Dutch army led by Prince William of Orange, who rode not a white horse, but a black one, and was supported strongly by the Pope of the time. The Catholic Church in Europe, learning of William's victory, sounded the cathedral bells to give thanks to God for William's victory. England from the beginning took the Protestant faith, except for a few brief years of Catholic rule under the Stuarts. So, Ireland was always a weak spot, a potential target for invaders from the continent. Ireland had to be watched, laws had to be made to control the Catholic population. Those laws eventually became the penal laws, tough, brutal, efficient laws designed to break the spirit of Catholicism in Ireland. and don't forget it, in Britain as well. They worked up to a point in that they taught people who had no other differences to hate one another. I have no hesitation in saying that the penal laws kept Catholicism alive in Ireland through sheer cussedness. Looking back at the Inquisition, the Reformation, and the religious wars, we may be frightened by the sheer brutality and barbarism of it all. Believe it or not, the Spanish Inquisition liquidated over 6 million people during its existence. Most of the churches now admit that they were wrong. They were misguided. In fact, they were dangerously off the rails in those outlandish times. Now, there seems to be a change for the good. We can already see church and state separating. That can only do good for the different churches. Perhaps there is a chance for a return to the values of the Celtic Church, now that ignorance and fear are on the run. And now we can look back. Make allowance for weird and wrong decisions. Look back into the misty past, beyond Normans and Danes, back to the simple and dedicated faith of St. Macallan.
There was a time in Ireland before the cross was raised, when the mountains all were forested and wild deer grazed. Boy was taken captive from his Roman home in Wales to herd sheep upon a mountain. Oh,